Good morning once again. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you so much. This morning, our gospel lesson comes to us from the gospel according to St. John chapter 13, and we will read it here together, verses 31 through 35. John chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. If you'd like to follow along with this reading, you can find it on New Testament, page 101 in your pew Bible. John 13, 31 through 35. And here's what it says. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. But I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Love one another. I think it's both the plainest and clearest and yet the hardest command of all. It's sort of like telling a young child to listen or to pay attention. It seems like an easy enough instruction, but for a young child, listening can be about the hardest thing to do, except maybe for sitting still. Love one another. Jesus' words sound so simple, but when we really get down to trying to live them out, we who are weak, we who are broken, we who are prone to sin, it really isn't very simple at all. And yet this command stands at the very heart of Christianity, doesn't it? It encapsulates the full spirit of discipleship. When it comes to following Christ, there's nothing more important than to love. To love one another as he has loved us. But I guess the question before us today is, do we really love this world? Or maybe more to the point, do we really want to love this world? One Christian thinker has written, "It is decidedly impractical to love as Jesus loves." Admitting that our Lord's teachings challenge so much of what we hold dear. Now the thing is, it's easy to miss that challenge. It really is. It's easy to miss the challenge of this commandment of Jesus because we've heard it so much. And we have repeated so often this admonition to love one another, and we've done so to near redundancy, to the point that we even tune out when we become aware that another sermon on love is unfolding. And still somehow, to love well remains regularly elusive. We don't have to examine ourselves too deeply to see that we quite often fail in doing so. Part of the reason for this is because we have defined one another so narrowly that it typically means only the people who reinforce my sense of who I am. We ostracize entire populations through ageism and classism and racism and sexism or any other number of isms. We bully people who are different from us. We gossip and talk ugly about our peers or our co-workers. We hold grudges when someone acts contrary to our desires or otherwise hurts us. Yeah, I believe we can think of all kinds of ways that we do everything except love one another. And often this happens because we define love too narrowly or put ourselves above loving others before loving others. But love shows itself most fully, not by self-service or by simple declarations of affection, but by the goodness we render to those whom we profess to love. You see, love, the kind that Jesus commands of us, is all about others. Such love overflows into service, not in order to show off how hardworking it is, but because that's love's natural form. This is the kind of love that God has for us, the love that Jesus showed to this world during his time walking among us. We may ponder that. We may ponder at the mystery and vastness of this love, but it's at the very core of who God is and what God is calling us to do and who God is asking us to be. That evening in the upper room, what Jesus instructed his disciples for was more than just loving your neighbor as yourself. When Jesus says to us, "Love one another as I have loved you," he's reminding us again that true love is all about others, about serving God, by taking care of those whom God loves, serving God by taking care of those around us. And throughout his ministry on earth, this is exactly what Jesus did. He let his love for and obedience to God show through his care for others. Love took him to a wedding in Cana of Galilee, where he turned water into wine. Love led him to a well, where he encountered an ostracized woman and embraced her. Love brought him face to face with the Pharisees, whom he taught with patience even as they hurled insults at him. Love carried him among crowds where he touched, where he healed, and where he offered hope. Love directed him to the tomb of a deceased friend who walked out alive only moments later. Love moved him all the way to a cross, where in his death we learn that the greatest love is a life laid down for someone else. Certainly the love that Jesus shows us and asks of us is a sacrificial love, one born out of complete love for God who shows us, God who shows us how to love unconditionally and inclusively and fully. I suppose the question is, where will such obedient love take us? As I prepared for this message, I found in an online commentary a story that I think speaks to and answers this question. It's a little lengthy, so bear with me, but it was an Easter Sunday. A preacher at a church in the slums of New York was so tired at the end of the day that she just went to the edge of the chancel and pulled off her collar and plopped down with her feet draped over the edge. It had been a wonderful service with many people present. But as she sat there and looked up the middle aisle, she saw that she wasn't alone in the sanctuary. In the third row was a man seated, disheveled, and filthy. But this wasn't odd for that church. Struggling folks came in often, and just as often sought help. Still, as she sat there, she said to herself, what a way to end Easter Sunday. It's been such a celebratory day, such a joyful day, and here's a fellow probably wanting money for some more booze. The man approached her and was within about 5 feet when she caught a horrible stench. Worse, she said, than anything she'd smelled in her whole life. So awful that she could barely face the man to speak. But she took a deep breath and asked, what's your name? David. And how long have you been on the street? 6 years. How old are you, David? 32. And she said that he looked 50. Hair matted, front teeth missing, face weathered, eyes slightly glazed. Where'd you sleep last night, David? Abandoned truck. Pastor said that she kept a money clip that also held some credit cards, and she fumbled to pull the clip out, thinking that she'd give him some cash. That wasn't her norm. She usually would just take people out to eat to make sure that they didn't waste the money. But she was so tired, she just took out a few bills. But David pushed his finger in front of her. He said, I don't want your money. I want this Jesus, the one you were talking about, because I'm not going to make it. I'm going to die in the street. And she said, I completely forgot about David. Started to feel sorry for myself. I was going to give a couple of bucks to someone God had sent me just to get him out of my hair. I was only concerned about myself. Now, I could make the excuse that I was tired, but there is no excuse. I was not seeing this man the way God sees him. I wasn't feeling what God feels. But oh, did that change. She said David just stood there. And he didn't know what was happening as I began to weep. And then David began to weep. And I put my arms around him and he put his around me. And there we wept on each other. And the once horrid odor of this person became a beautiful aroma. The rest of that story, as I encountered it, is that David went on to rehab and is today a preacher of the gospel. You see, love is about so much more than convenience. It's about obedience, whatever the cost. You see, for that pastor, the cost was a smelly hug from a drunken homeless man. And for Christ, the cost was ultimately a cross. And there are certainly costs for us too, if we take this command from Jesus seriously. Because loving Jesus' way means that we'll have to die for self, but such death is key to life. It's true that loving this way is not safe. Loving this way is not comfortable. Loving this way is messy, but it's the only way to find joy and happiness and true freedom. Amen. And if we love this way, we will find ourselves in the blighted neighborhoods, in the mental health facilities, in the prisons. We will ache with the burden of carrying loads of food or bags of clothes or fixing disrepaired homes. Our time will fill up as we take moments to tell others about the amazing love of a Savior, and our purses and wallets will lighten as we contribute to transformative efforts. We'll have to work against the cynicism and skepticism of others, and we just might even lose relationships in the process. But love, Christ-like love, it isn't about us anyway. Once again, it's always about us. And the newness of this commandment from Jesus is not a matter of never having heard these words before. Even the disciples had heard before this admonition to love. We have heard before this admonition to love. The newness of this commandment is not that we haven't heard it before. It's a matter of grasping the mode of this love, the genuineness of this love, the depth and type of this love, that we would love one another in the same way that we have been loved by Christ. Because such love overflows into being and into doing, because this is love's true form. This is love's natural form. This is the love for which we are made. And it's the badge that the Christian wears before a watching world. So what will the world see when they watch us? Will they see the obedient and sacrificial love of Jesus? Do people know that you are a disciple of the Christ by how you love? Because all else is gathered up in that. This command from Jesus is clear, but the choice is ours. Love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. May God's love find new expressions in and through each of us today and every day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.